the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins,
God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. He is called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, And for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Understanding in all things, and evermore to rejoice in his holy consolation. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Testament reading for the day of Pentecost, Genesis chapter 11. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words. And as people migrated from the east, they found a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. And they said to one another, "Come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly." They had brick for stone and bitumen for mortar. they said, Come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth. The Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of man had built. The Lord said, Behold, they are one people, and they all have one language. And this is only the beginning of what they will do. And nothing that they propose to do will be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and there confuse their language so that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord dispersed them from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth, and from there the Lord dispersed them over the face of all the earth. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Second reading from Acts chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place, and suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound, the multitude came together, and they were bewildered, because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. They were amazed and astonished, saying, Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in his own native language? Parthians and Medes and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians, we hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God. And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, What does this mean? But others, mocking, said, They are filled with new wine. But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them, Men of Judea, and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and give ear to my words. For these men are not drunk, as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was uttered through the prophet Joel, In the last days it shall be, God declares, that I'll pour out my spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my male servants and female servants in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Gospel according to St. John, the 14th chapter. Jesus answered him, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our home with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. And the word that you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. These things I have spoken to you while I am still with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away, and I will come to you. If you loved me, you would have rejoiced, because I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. Now I have told you before it takes place, so that when it does take place, you may believe. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. He has no claim on me, but I do as the Father has commanded me, so that the world may know that I love the Father. Rise, let us go from here." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
each of you the peace and joy which come only from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He is the one who was, who is, and who is yet to come. The text for today's sermon is the Gospel from John chapter 14. To many, doctrine is a bad word, something that people create to meet a need. In school, you probably learned about social and political doctrines. Any of you remember the Monroe Doctrine? Well, don't worry if you don't, because it's not that important. Such doctrines may be interesting, and they might even be useful for a little while, but life will go on without them. For us, Christian doctrine, church doctrine, is different. We aren't united in some cultic, unique, changeable teaching, but by the truth by which Christ has set us free from sin and has given us everlasting life. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, is Christ's promised comforter, who by the doctrine of God's word gives you the comfort and the security of Christ's forgiveness, the comfort that comes by teaching you the truth about your Savior, who is the way, the truth, and the life. We confessional Lutherans don't claim to have special doctrine. We simply confess the teaching that Christ entrusted once and for all to the apostles. If our teaching isn't Christ's apostolic teaching, it would be a sin for me to teach it, and it would be deadly for all of you to believe it and to confess it. Now, the interesting thing about God's doctrine is that it doesn't teach us things just to satisfy our curiosity. In fact, many of the things that people are most naturally curious about never ever get addressed in God's word. His teaching is about Christ. It's always centered in Christ. His work is to tell us about him, and that's why the Holy Spirit was sent. So, if you hear something from a pulpit and it's not about Christ, then it is not the Holy Spirit speaking. There are plenty of false spirits out there, and they simply do not teach Christ's doctrine. Our Lord and Savior's words recorded in our text were first addressed to the 11 remaining apostles. He promised them the Holy Spirit would teach them all things. And the Holy Spirit did teach the apostles all the things that Christ had taught them and which Christ wanted them to teach to all the nations. They were, in fact, even inspired by that same Holy Spirit to write these things down. And it's why we have Christ's teaching in the Holy Scriptures, and it's why we treasure the Bible so highly. So, to know about Christ, you must read Scripture. And if as you're reading it, you're not learning about Christ, then you're not reading with the true eyes of faith, but with blinders on. Expect to learn about Christ when you are reading God's word. Anyone who might want to see and understand the things of God, but neglects, refuses, or denies what the Bible says is true, that person is actually sinning against the Holy Spirit. And that person will never ever see the real Christ. That person will see only what they want, and they will die outside the grace of Christ's forgiveness. The true Christ is the one that's in the Bible. The only reason God caused Scripture to be written was so that you could know and you could believe in him. All the false teachings out there have two things in common. Number one, they can disagree with the Bible. And secondly, they lead you away from Christ. Christ and the Bible go together. That means Christ and the Holy Spirit always go together. When Christ received his human nature from Mary, the Bible says he was conceived in Mary's womb by the Holy Spirit. When Christ was baptized, the Father spoke from heaven and the Holy Spirit descended upon him like a dove. Just before Christ ascended into heaven, Christ promised to send to the church his Holy Spirit. On Pentecost, he fulfilled that promise. The Holy Spirit filled the apostles and gave them the ability to preach God's word in languages that they had never ever learned before. Pentecost means 50 days. Before that day, Pentecost had always been just a Jewish festival. It had commemorated how 50 days after the original Passover in Egypt, when the angel of death passed over the children of Israel, 50 days later, out in the Sinai, God gave his law to Moses. So among Christians, Pentecost now commemorates the outpouring of the Holy Spirit 50 days after Christ rose from the dead. The ultimate purpose of the Egyptian Passover was fulfilled when Christ was crucified on the cross. Because Christ Jesus is our true Passover lamb, he has taken away all our sin. The exodus from Egypt that God worked, that freed the children of Israel from their slavery, that was simply a foretaste of Christ's resurrection from the dead, because his resurrection sets us free from slavery to sin. The full purpose of God's law given to Moses has been fulfilled in Christ our Savior. The law, as it was given, had promised grace and every blessing to those who obey it, but threatened to punish all who disobeyed. As you all know, the law doesn't bring peace, because what it does is always expose every sin that we think, that we say, and that we do. The law always uncovers, accuses, judges, and condemns us. There can be no spiritual comfort in God's commands. In Deuteronomy 27, Moses announced each sin that God condemned, and then God pronounced God's curse on those who would do them. And after every curse, the people were commanded to say, "Amen." That is, "So be it. It is your will, God, and it shall be done." Unlike us, God's law doesn't judge unfairly. When God's law condemns us as sinners, it is perfectly just, perfectly fair, and it is always right. And so that's all we can do. All we can say is amen. So be it. Because we know God's law is right. Or do you think God is wrong when he forbids hatred and lust, envy and greed, and every other kind of evil desire? Is God wrong when he requires you to conform your life to his commandments? There is absolutely nothing wrong with the commandments. It's just that everything is wrong with us. It's why every effort to find peace with God by outwardly trying to obey his law will fail. Now, it might make sense to believe you're going to find true peace by doing the things that God wants you to do. It might be reasonable to assume genuine spiritual peace will come to you after you've done what God says. It might be rational to believe the way to peace with God is paved with sincere effort to do your part about bringing that peace about. But what's reasonable is absolutely wrong. We can't make peace with God by anything we do. We need Christ to give us his peace. And when the Holy Spirit teaches you the teaching of Christ, he brings to your heart that peace of God, a peace that you cannot know by your own reason or strength. It is given only by the Holy Spirit. Remember, the Bible shows us that Christ was already promised in the Old Testament. Abraham called him Shiloh, the man of peace. Isaiah called him the Prince of Peace. After promising the apostles his Holy Spirit and that he would teach them everything, Christ said, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled or afraid." You see, earthly peace attempts to establish itself by making and imposing laws on you. The law tries to keep an outward peace by causing people to fear breaking it. In other words, the law doesn't make bad people good. It just tries to keep their badness in line. That's not the way it is with Christ's peace. It does make bad people into good. Not by the strength of force, but by the power of Christ's holy, precious blood and his innocent suffering and death. He did much more than promise a peaceful feeling for those who received his teaching. Shortly after giving his promise to the disciples, he went to the cross, and there he offered to the Heavenly Father his spotless obedience, his moral purity, his pure love, and his holy suffering. There, Christ made peace between sinners and the holy God. Christ's offering on your behalf has graciously become your offering to God, because Christ offered himself as your substitute. By that precious exchange, his life for yours, he satisfied God's anger over our sin, and he established permanent peace between himself and between all of mankind. That peace is what the Holy Spirit gives, and he comforts your heart with it according to the gift of faith. It's the peace that passes all understanding, the peace of sin forgiven, and certainty that God regards you as innocent and fully righteous in Christ's righteousness, which has been given to you. The reason you now believe and believe these things about Christ is because the Holy Spirit has created this faith in your heart. In this world, whatever outward peace can be established by sinful, fallible men, that also is God's gift to us. So thank God. Thank him for the privilege of living in a free country where you can enjoy whatever peace may be established by laws and the customs of men. But to have a peaceful conscience is so much greater. You can endure war and want and violence of every description and still have the peace of God. This is what Christ gives by the teaching of the Holy Spirit. So as Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Your Heavenly Father is at peace with you. You have everlasting peace. God is both able and willing to keep you in the true faith. Christ has removed any and all reason for you to fear. In Acts chapter 2, Peter concluded his Pentecost sermon by saying, therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Those who heard it were cut to the heart, Scripture says. They were then moved by the Holy Spirit to ask, what shall we do? And Peter answered, repent, and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. You've been baptized in the name of Christ Jesus. You have received the forgiveness of sin. You have received the gift of the Holy Spirit. He has taught you the teaching of Christ that has brought you peace. By faith's gift, continue confessing the truth that the Spirit has taught you. It's more precious than anything. Money, popularity, physical strength, talent, whatever other earthly blessings that you value, all those can and they will be lost. But in your baptism, God forgave you the sins that you had. He delivered you from the death and the devil. He has given you everlasting life. God's not fickle. He doesn't change his mind. He won't withdraw the promises that he gave you in your baptism. When he makes a promise, he sticks to it. Your pastors, they cannot convince you of these things that are true. But the Holy Spirit can, and he will. And it's why you'll always need to be taught by him. His teaching defies the world's wisdom, and it keeps you in the true faith. It comforts you in every sorrow. It fills your life with peace. It confirms you in the grace of baptism for the rest of your life, and it leads you to heaven on the day that you die. It's the one thing that you need. So be stubborn! Stubborn about receiving it rightly. The Holy Spirit has promised you the crown of life. By faith, hold to God's word, which the Holy Spirit has taught you. For the glory of Jesus' precious name, amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In our prayers this morning, we remember Herb Strain and his wife Joan. Herb is nearing death. We pray the litany on page 288. O Lord,
have mercy.
O Christ,
have mercy.
O Lord,
have mercy.
O Christ,
have mercy.
God the Father in heaven,
have mercy.
God the Son, Redeemer of the world,
have mercy.
God the Holy Spirit,
have mercy.
Be gracious to us. Be gracious to us. From all sin, from all error, from all evil, from the crafts and assaults of the devil, sudden and evil death, from pestilence and famine, from war and bloodshed, from sedition and rebellion, from lightning and tempest, from all calamity by fire and water, and from everlasting death. By the mystery of your holy incarnation, by your holy nativity, by your baptism, fasting, and temptation, by your agony and bloody sweat, by your cross and passion, by your precious death and burial, by your glorious resurrection and ascension, and by the coming of the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, in all time of our tribulation, in all time of our prosperity, in the hour of death, and in the day of judgment, we poor sinners implore you to rule and govern your holy Christian church, preserve all pastors and ministers of your church in the true knowledge and understanding of your wholesome word, and to sustain them in holy living, to put an end to all schism and cause of offense, to bring into the way of truth all who have erred and are deceived, to beat down Satan under our feet, to send faithful laborers into your harvest, and to accompany your word with grace and spirit, raise those who fall and strengthen those who stand, to comfort and help the weak-hearted and the distressed, to give to all peoples concord and peace, to preserve our land from discord and strife, to give our country your protection in every time of need, to direct and defend our president and all in authority, to bless and protect our magistrates and all our people, to watch over and help all who are in danger, necessity, and tribulation, to protect and guide all who travel, to grant all women with child and all mothers with infant children increasing happiness and their blessings, to defend all orphans and widows and provide for them, to strengthen and keep all sick persons and young children, to free those in bondage and to have mercy on us all. Give our enemies, persecutors, and slanderers, and to turn their hearts, to give and preserve for our use the kindly fruits of the earth, and graciously to hear our prayers. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, Christ, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, Christ, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, Christ, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. O Christ, O Lord, O Christ, O Lord.
Welcome to all of you today. It is our duty and it is our delight to celebrate the sacrament of our Lord's body and blood. We believe, teach, and confess about this sacrament exactly what God's Word says of it, that it offers to us under the outward forms of bread and wine the very body and the very blood of Christ to eat and to drink, its primary benefit being the forgiveness of sin. We believe, teach, and confess also this sacrament to be celebrated in the unity of the faith we confess together before this altar. Therefore, along with the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, we practice what's called close or closed or fellowship communion. If you're a member of Trinity of another LCMS congregation, or you've spoken to Pastor Shelby and myself about receiving the sacrament here, you intend to do so today, please fill out the card, put a mark next to your name indicating you went to the sacrament, and hand this card to the usher when you come to the pew. If you're visiting with us and you have a need, a way we can help, anything we can do for you, we'd love to do that. Indicate that for us on the visitor side of the card, fill it out, lay it beside you in the pew. It'll be picked up after this divine service.
Thank you.
your hearts.
We lift to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who ascended above the heavens and sitting at your right hand, poured out on this day the promised Holy Spirit on his chosen disciples. For all this, the whole world rejoices. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you, body and soul, unto life everlasting. Depart in peace.
Beloved in the Lord, in holy baptism, you became members of the Holy Christian Church, and our Lord's word and sacraments have nourished you in this congregation for 3.5 years. As we bid you farewell and Godspeed, hear the words of the Apostle Paul. I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you, all making my prayer with joy, because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we give thanks that you have so faithfully nourished our Timothy and Mary with us in the communion of this congregation. Bless, protect, and defend them as they now depart from us. Preserve them in the confession of your name and in loving service to others. Keep us in fellowship with all your saints and bring us at last to the joys of your heavenly kingdom through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Go in peace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Thank you.
Stay one night and then get on that track, but you're out.